Right. But just to clarify that, what I'm asking for this question two is it true that every time, like, that's a complete perfect, right? There's nothing else to that. So every time it gets run, will it produce the same output? So if we, and let's just say we get a specific number, right? If we run this exact same thing again, will we see the same number or a different number? So the question number two is, if we got, let's just call it X, right? If we got output of X from that little mini program, the next time we ran it, will we see X or will we see something else? What I want to do today is talk about last week's quiz. Walk through that. So I'm going to turn the light off so we can see what's going on here. Okay, so first off, right, so when using a while loop, what's important, right? So the key thing with a while loop is to make sure it stops. So really easy thing to do with a while loop is to end up in what's called an endless loop. So generally, that's almost always a bad thing. Right? You need to break out of it somehow. Now that's slightly modified in the case of games, which is generally is something, you know, we'll call a game loop, or that is generally called a game loop. That's an endless loop, but for the life of the game. And you have to have a way to quit that, though, as well. So even if you have a game loop, which you guys will for your games, right, there's going to be some user action that can break out of that loop. So that's the key thing about a while loop. So, B. Right answer, right? While clause is guaranteed to eventually be false, one way or another. Everything else, I just realized I have an error here in the explanation. So the while clause does not contain numbers. Totally doesn't matter. You can have numbers, you can have booleans, you can have functions that call out stuff. Anything you want, as long as it can get evaluated to a true or false value. Anything's fair game, right? So A is totally fine. C, nesting is totally fine. We're going to talk about that a little bit today when we talk about more complex logical clauses. So it's totally fine to have multiple. Counter is greater than or equal to zero and is active is fine. While clause is based on integer value, it doesn't matter, right? If you have numbers, there's nothing. So He's the key message. Any questions on number one? Cool. All right, so number two, this is fairly straightforward. Right, most people did pretty well with this. So key thing is it has to be letters and numbers and underscores, and it can't start with a number. The only thing that was a little bit tricky here was ints, which is perfect, which would otherwise be totally fine, right? INT would be fine, but why isn't it fine? Alright, it's taken, right? So, C++ defines a bunch of keywords, that's the nature of the language, and if we start using those keywords as variable names, then the compiler doesn't know what to do. Right, so that's standard across all languages. The specific keywords may be different, but there's always going to be some list of words you can't use because they're taken. Right. So, everything else should be fairly straightforward. So, to my num, can't start with a number. This is actually a little tricky too, because this is a valid expression. It's just not a valid variable name. Right? So, the num is totally fine. Exclamation point, the num, what does that mean? Nothing, right? So it's taking whatever the logical value of that is and inverting it. So that's actually fine, but it's not a variable. Yeah. Exclamation always means not. So my num2 is valid. That num, you can't have extra characters, and that knocks out both this. That and that are all knocked out because they have something that's not a letter, a number, or an underscore. Okay? And then my space number, no space. Okay? You could have my and you could have number, but that gets evaluated as two separate things. So doesn't make sense. Okay, now the one that's out, I think pretty much everybody. Remember correctly. I'm sorry. I promise I wasn't trying to be mean with this. And as I mentioned, I promise you, you will see it in your lives as programmers. It's good to recognize this. So, what this is about, right, is the OX is the key thing here. The OX at the start of a number means that it's hexadecimal, meaning base 16. Right? So, 1-0 always means that you have, 0-1, right, because the 1 place, no matter what base we're in, is 1. Always represents 1. 1 to the left of the 1 place represents whatever the base is. So in our normal numbers, that's the tens place, right? And one step over from that is 100, and et cetera, et cetera, right? So in base 16, it's what? 16, right? So we have 116 and 01. So 10 in any base is the base of that base, right? So 10 in binary is what? 2. 10 in 37, right? So 10, and it's just the OX, you just have to remember, and that's arbitrary, right? The OX means hexadecimal. There's nothing about OX that inherently means hexadecimal. It's just a convention that we use so that we can write numbers and be clear that we mean not base 10. Alright, so sorry. But like I said, good thing to know, and you will encounter it. Okay, so last one. Not necessarily. That's a great question. Okay, so what computers use is always, always, always binary. Or I should qualify that a little bit. What a computer uses is always just ons and offs. Very often, that corresponds to binary numbers, but not exactly always, right? So, floating point variables, which we're going to talk about in a minute, we've kind of used them a little bit, we're going to talk about them a little bit more at the start of today's class. That's a little bit different, so it's not quite as straightforward as just, 000 is 0, and then 1, 70 to the left is 1, and then counting up to that. The computer is just using 1-0. Usually that means binary. And hexadecimal has a nice interrelated binary in a nice way. So the problem with binary is that it's really long, right? But we only have a maximum of two states. So if you want to represent anything above, you know, let's say, you know, 16 or so, you have to have a pretty long, like, list of digits to do it. Right? So that's the nice thing about decimals, right? With four digits, we can represent up to 999. Right? I'm sorry, 9,999. Right? You can go almost to 10,000 with four digits. With binary four digits, how many things can we get? Well, how many do we get with one? One binary digit. Think in terms of how many states it can be in. Two, right? I guess two. So one binary digit is this two. What's two binary digits? Yes. Four, right? Because we have two states times two states, right? And then three digits gives us eight, and then four is 16, right? So with four binary digits in base two, we can only count to 0 to 15, right? In base 10, we can count from 0 to 9,000, right? So that's nice, right? But 10, transferring between base 10 and base 2 doesn't really work so well. Base 16 or base 8, the binary, is much more streamlined. Why do you think that might be? What possible relationship can you see between 2, binary, and both 8 and 16? Close. Right, so let's restate that a little bit. So to go from 8 to 16, you do one. Right, how do you get to 8? Involving 2. Right, exactly. So they're powers of 2, right? So there's this really nice interrelationship between base 16 and base 8 numbers and base 2 numbers. Because those bases are multiples of each other. So it's kind of like, you know, we want to think about what you have to do if you have a number. It's kind of like, all right, so you go to a restaurant, right? You're trying to calculate a tip. Really easy way to do it is, you know, let's say you're going for 20%, right? So you can really quickly and easily get 10% by just moving a decimal, right? Because 1/10 is an easy multiple of a decimal base, right? So you don't really have to think about it. You just move the decimal over, right? And you've got 10%. And you can multiply that by 2 and you get 20%, right? So it's really easy. So in a similar way, dealing with binary to hex or octal is really easy. Whereas dealing with binary to base 10 is a little harder. And so yet another way that we'll see, and you guys will see it a lot in your lifetimes as engineers, that base 2 is everywhere. If you guys read Snow Crash, anybody? Okay, you gotta read Snow Crash. It's one of the absolute classics. So Snow Crash is very important, and it's got a really beautiful paragraph. It's about the virtual world, which is, you know, sci-fi thriller kind of thing. I think it was Snow Crash. No, I'm sorry, Neuromancer. It's got this really beautiful paragraph talking about how in the virtual world, everything is powers of 2, and why that is. It's like 512 blocks, 1024 blocks. It's just inherent in the way this works. So, yeah. You will see hex a lot because it's a more efficient way to get a binary. And it's very straightforward to go back and forth. Octal you used to see, but not so much anymore. That was more in sort of like older days of computing where 8 bits was actually like a thing. Now we tend to use, you know, 1632 or not. So anyways, it's okay.
Thank you.
Okay, cool. So last one. I think this was maybe, you know, I apologize, guys. I think maybe my wording was a little bit off. But what I was looking for here is there's three clauses. Which one will we hit, and how many maximum will we hit? So again, you know, you can think of it. This is all one structure because it's an if, an else if, and an else, right? It's not separate if statements. It's one big interrelated block. We have if, else if, else. So given that it's one interrelated block, it's kind of like, you know, that metaphor of, you know, a coin sorting bank, where a coin rolls down and it goes through, it passes, it might pass almost all slots, but it goes through a maximum of one slot. Right, so you roll a dollar, it goes to the dollar coin, you know, we pass right past the dime size slot, the smallest coin, we pass the nickel size slot, we pass the quarter size slot, and then go in at the end. Right? The dime would fall from the first slot, which is the smallest, and nothing else would happen. So, so just by the virtue of it being an if-else-if-else construction, you know that a maximum of one of those blocks is ever going to happen. No way multiple can happen with this control block. Right, so that was the second part. I was looking for one there. There's no way for multiple of those to happen. And then the other thing is just, you know, let's just walk through it, right? So test value starts out as true. I say if not test value, right? So not true is false. So we don't do this. We pass by Allen Turing. And then we check to see if 2 is less than or equal to 2. Which is less than or equal, if that's true. Right? So we see Grace Hopper, and then we're done. So we don't even attempt to get the article.
Yeah. So
Grace
Hopper is
there's no possibility of 3 here at all, right? So we have 3 options, only one of which can ever happen. Now, if we have different values for test value and my num, we might get a different result. We can certainly, what would have to change to give us Allen Turing? Right, so we change this to false, right? Test value goes false. Then we say, if not false, which is true. So then we see Allen Turing. Okay. What would we have to do? Right. So my num would have to be strictly greater than 2. And this would have to remain true. Right? So this would we need this to fail and this to fail to get to our else.
So why do
this is kind of a toy example, right? But what I would really do is I probably wouldn't have just 3 CF, right? This would be more like a situation where we have 3 possible options. Like it might be the case that maybe we're building something where someone can possibly buy a thing, right? So it's like, is the shop open? Yeah. Right? It might be, if we're dealing with something like Skyrim, we could have a little day and night cycle and hours of operations and things, right? So you could say, is the shop even open? So if it's not, then we're done, right? We say, door locked or whatever, and a lot of that. Then we say, okay, well, do you have enough money? And if not, then, we do something else. And then finally, so that would be inverting the logic a little bit. We'd be testing to see different reasons why you couldn't do it. But it's the same sort of setup, right? We'd say, if shop not open, do a thing. Else, if you don't have enough money, do something else. And then if all of that succeeds, right? If we pass through those, right? And we know the shop is open, and the player has enough money at the moment, or whatever they put on, right? Then, finally, we can do something that's like actually taking some money from their inventory and giving them, a health potion or whatever it was.
So, you mean the other CLs is only for loading
content? Yeah, well, the CI here is just a stand-in. So, it's just a stand-in to kind of, it's kind of how we're using CI a lot. Right? We're using CI in a really easy, straightforward way to just get something that we can look at and see the results. But, in almost all cases, our C outs are kind of stand-ins for more complex logic that you guys will build as you get more comfortable with them. Cool. All right, guys. So yeah, that's the last quiz. Cool. Any other questions on that? Cool. All right. So today I'm going to start off by talking about floats a little bit. So this isn't going to take long, but we've used floats a little bit, right? So mainly what we've done so far in the class are integers, and we use strings a little bit without talking about them too much, because there's actually kind of a lot going on with a string, as opposed to a constant char array, so a constant char pointer, which we'll talk about. But if you want a value that kind of represents a how much value, not a how many, you need a float. So float short for floating point, right? So first thing I want to talk about is that, you can declare a float quite normal. But there's still this idea, we talked a little bit about integers and size, right? I think we got that. But we talked about having the maximum int, right? And you can make an unsigned int, which means that the computer interprets those bits a little bit differently. Right? Why would I want to make something an unsigned int? No? You sure? Okay. Sure, yeah. So there's kind of, so one of the things you always want to be thinking about when you're implementing anything, right, is how much space are you using? That can become very important, right? And even though it's not going to make much difference right now in this class and stuff we do here, we're just starting out, but I encourage you guys to always kind of be thinking about that. And C++ kind of forces you to think about that a lot more than other languages do. You're going to have to pay attention to how much memory are we using? And there's situations where it might be beneficial, like if we know for a fact, right, that a given attribute of, let's say, a character is only ever going to be one of 16 values. What's the minimum number of bits I need to store that? Zero is no information, right? How many light switches do I need to store a maximum of 16 values? Four, right? 2 to the 4, right? And 16. And how many bits do I use for a normal int? This is one of the things I want to show you guys. So, let me make start an example project here. Call it 4. Standard new item, C++ file. And I'll add our standard string using namespace standard int main This will mean more later in the semester when we start talking about dynamic memory. But one of the things I want to do with you guys in the class is for any of the really like complex topics, I want to make sure we hit it a couple of times before we really talk about it, right? So sort of in advance of what we'll get through with dynamic memory is you want to know how big things are at all times, right? It's easy to think that these computers are these magical boxes, but they're not. They're physical devices like anything else. And there's physics, right? And there's real limits. So one of the things you can do is you can always check how big something is with size of. So I'm going to say, size of int. Now what this is going to do, and the reason you might want to do this, is if you look at the C++ reference, right, you'll see there's all these different types of variables. The key ones, the most important, are integer and float and string, to a higher level, but there are different flavors of int, and there are different flavors of float. And some of those are system dependent. So if you look into the documentation, you'll see stuff that says, this is guaranteed to be at least this size, but might be bigger, right? So one thing you might want to know is on the system you're running on, how big is an int? Right, so if we do this, Sorry, I need to. So, let's do our standard little trick here. Reading something in. So it's up. Okay, we see four. So, what that four actually means is not bits. Because we're sufficiently far from the early days of computing that it's very rare to actually do something with bits directly. So, generally, what's the smallest amount of memory we ever deal with? Byte, right? So 8 bits. 1 byte is the sort of smallest bit of memory that ever really gets dealt with. So size of it is going to tell us how many bytes go into whatever this is. So an int is 4 bytes. There's 32 byte widgets, right? So that's a lot. There's no way around that. So let's see what an unsigned is. So just to be clear, size of is going to take a table. It's going to take a type, and it's going to tell us how big that type is in bytes. Okay, so let me get this bigger. A little bit bigger. Okay, so we see 4 and 4, right? So Jack said that we might want an unsigned int because we might want a bigger number, right? And you're right, that's part of the reason you want to use it. But notice that it's the same number of bytes, right? So is there any difference in number of possible values between an int and an unsigned int? No. No negative, though, right? So, that's kind of unsigned is if you know something, it's never going to be negative, which could definitely be the case, right? Like, if you're making a game and you're talking about number of bullets in a clip, I have no idea what a negative number of bullets would mean, right? There are some things that just negative numbers cannot exist. Right? For those situations, you can use a smaller int type and have it be unsigned. Kind of nice thing too is that it kind of helps you a little bit because you know, it's something that you never have a negative value, you will never have a negative value. So it's a good idea. And so just to kind of finish this off, right, and go if I close, one of the differences in types in C++ is it's really easy. If you look up C++ types, there's kind of a lot. There's way more in sort of base types than you see in other languages that came later. Right? Not because C++ is really doing more, it's just, it's kind of hiding less from it. So, with numbers in C++, you kind of have two choices. It doesn't have a decimal part. Yes or no, right? If no, it's no. If not, if it does, it's a flip. Then you also can choose how big you want it to be. So we have int, unsigned int, right? That's the same. We can also have long int. We can also have short. You see 2, 4, 4. So that's right. So 2, our short int, is 2. Right? Meaning it's only 2 bytes. So it has less space, but there's always trade-offs, right? That might seem like a universally bad thing, but not necessarily. If you know that your values that you're storing in that variable are never going to exceed what you can represent with 2 bytes, you might want to do that. People nodding off. I know this is not the most interesting bit, but it's stuff you guys need to know. So I'll kind of get through this. But alright, so upshot is int and long int are the same. You can also have a long, which will generally give you 8 bytes. the specifics don't matter that much. I just want you guys, because I want to walk through it, I want you guys to be aware there are limits, right? And when things go wrong, that's something you want to be aware of. So, if you do a lot of, like, programming challenges, like Project Euler, which is, like, it's a bunch of mathematical programming challenges, a lot of the sort of problem you have to solve is getting around the limits of variable math, right? Is, you know, it'll be asking you to do math on very large numbers, and numbers that are far in excess of what you can represent with 4 bytes. So, always something you want to be aware of. Okay, so with floats, there's something similar, right? So, you can make a float. And then you can also have a double, which is just a larger float. So we see it's 4 and 8, right? So the double is just double the size of a float, they do the same thing. Okay, so that's all well and good, right? Now, the real thing I do want to talk about, and this is crucial, this is something that will, I guarantee, sneak up on you in weird ways, you least expected, probably at like 3 in the morning. So, when you're dealing with floats, which you'll often be doing, right, is anything that has a how much rather than a how many kind of nature, right, must be a float or a double. Right? So they're called floats because that decimal point can move around. Now, here's a big thing that gets a lot of people. Floats are kind of fuzzy. So as you do math on floats, you'll see this in pretty much any language. It's a byproduct of how computers work. It's never going away, probably. In fact, I can't conceive of a way that it would go away. So we have, you know, a set number of bits representing a float. It's translated into floating point values, which is a little complicated. It moves around, it will move around. But as the conceptual problem, let's say that I have the smallest possible number, right? Because any variable has limits on what it can represent, right? In some way. There's some sort of limit, right? And the really simple example is if we have an unsigned int with, 4 bits, let's say, we get 0 to 15, right? That's it. But every other type of variable in any language anywhere has limits on what it can represent. So let's just think that we had, you know, something that was 0, 0, 1. Let's just say, for the sake of argument, that this is the smallest number that a given variable type can represent. Right? Let's say, you know, we're in some random language. We're not really in C++ land right now. Just conceptually, right? We have, you know, let's say that there's something, a type called small float. And I set it to 0.001, right? Now, in this language, right, it's a decent language, so it implements all the standard mathematical operators. So I could say my num divided by 2, right? Which should mean 0.0005, right? If we're talking about real math in the real world, that's easy, right? Everything is infinitely divisible. There's an infinite number of values between any two numbers, et cetera, right? But real world math is not the same as computer math. Because all computer math has to be built out of these, you know, circuits, right? And strict on and offs or strict limits. So, what do you think the answer would be? What value would this have? If this is the smallest thing we can represent, we divide it by 2. Maybe. It might do that with the thing in the implementation. It would probably give us 0, 0, 0. But it would be wrong if it was the key, right? So the upshot is that down at the end of the precision with floats, they get fuzzy. Now, you don't always see it, and that's why I'm kind of belaboring this a little bit. Because it's really easy to start working with floats and just treat them like integers and not worry about it as much. But it's really important to be aware that they're always a little bit fuzzy. So if you declare a float, you can totally cut off. I'm going to go back to actual C++. Let's say I can totally declare a float. Now this in and of itself is an integer, right? But I say float my num. This effectively gets promoted to a float. There's nothing wrong with that. Totally fine. So it's essentially 2.00000, right? However, as we go through our program, we might be doing math to this. And the important thing to know is that as you do math to floats, they might not give you exactly what you expect. So if we do a whole bunch of math, that should bring us back to 2. Right? Let's say we, you know, think of like one of those, you know, if you guys ever had did as a kid, there's like sort of like magic tricks where it's basically like an elaborate way to multiply by 10 and then divide by 10. But it's broken up into like, you know, multiply by 5 and then some other stuff, and then multiply by 2, and then eventually divide by 10. You get the same number, right? So we can do a whole bunch of math here, right? It should theoretically, and would in real math land, right, in the real world, get us back to 2. But in computers, because things are a little fuzzy, we could end up with either 2.000001 or 1.999999. So, now the bad news here is that there's no way around that. It's fundamental to representing fuzzy, like, decimal values with this. So, I mean, I could be wrong, and I would be glad to be wrong about this, but I don't think this is ever going away, ever, 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 right? Now, with more bits, you've got more room. So, you know, you might not hit that sort of tail end of the precision as quickly or as often. But it's still going to be there, and it's still going to sneak up on you in weird ways. So, one of the things that happens is that who here has done like level design? Is there any like level editors? Okay. So one thing I don't know if this is still the case. It's been a while for me. But when level design tools were first getting started, they had forced you to be very discrete and put things right on the grid. And the reason for that is you wanted whole numbers. Because as stuff gets rotated and translated, right? What the computer's doing to render it is it's taking the position of the polygon, doing a whole bunch of math to it, and then spitting out the position on the screen. And the theoretical math works out perfect, right? But when you're actually doing it with floating point values, it cracks and seams. And the reason for that is because of this. Right? So let's just think that, you know, this is that we're calculating the x position of two triangles that go right up next to each other, right? So we've got vertex here, vertex here, and they should be right on top of each other. But for one triangle, we get 2.0001, and for the other triangle, we get 1.9999, right? And so you get a tiny little gap, right? So that's one of the reasons level editors had to make the level itself on very clear lines. Because those gaps, especially if it was a collision mesh, those gaps, that's how you ended up like falling through the world. So, floating point error can be a problem, and will never go away. So what do you do about it, right? So, one thing that I want to warn you guys off of, right? So this gets everybody. This isn't quite as bad as the using a single equals for equality checking, but it's up there. As far as things that people starting out with programming try and get tripped up on. Let's say I have a float, right? And I'm going to say it's 2, right? Let's say I do a bunch of math to it, and it really ends up, after some math, it's something like that, right? Now let's say I want to check that to see if it's 2. So conceptually, what I want is I want to say this. I want to say, if my num equals 2. Now, just to, like I'm saying, if I really was going to compare this to integers a lot, I would at least want to ask myself, does this really need to be a float? But let's just pretend like this absolutely must be a float for some reason, right? And we want to compare it to something that's net. What would happen? What would I see? Which one would press? Press default, right? Because 2 is not the same as 2.00001, right? So, upshot there is never do this. Never take a float and use a simple this double equal to compare. So, what can we do? Greater than what? What do we compare? Good idea, right? So, you're really close, right? So the key thing that we have to do is we can't test for equality with a float. What we can test for, though, is distance. So we can see how far away is it from our target. Right, so if we think about it on a number line, if we have a number line that's, so an int, you know, we just have this nice dot, right? That's right there, it's 2, right? And, you know, here we've got 1, and there's nothing in between there, right? So it's click, 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 right? So n3. Floats can be, you know, fuzzy, right? So it can be right here or right there, right? So conceptually what we want to do is we want to define some span that's not too big, right? We want it to be basically 2, right? But we want some little span here. We're going to be a fuzzy, fuzzy range. How do we do that? Right, so that would do it, right? So let's say that we want this to be 0.001 plus or minus, right? That gives us, you know, if it's greater than or equal to 1.999, yeah, and it's less than or equal to 2.001, okay? So we can do that. Let's call it a good word. And here's a slightly quicker and easier way to do it, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to look at the difference between my number and what I'm looking for. So I'm going to start with I'll say my num minus 2. That's what I'm looking for. And I'm going to say if that is less than some small number. Will that do it? Will this happen? Alright, so let's say that I've got, let's call this value A, right here, slightly less than 2. Let's call this value B, slightly greater than 2. As I got it written, will it detect A, B, neither, or both? Well, it will in this case, right? Yeah. So you're right that in this case, since we're a little bit above, right? So we're just a tiny bit above. But what we have to account for is my num can be a little bit above 2 or a little bit below 2. Right? So, right now we're looking for, this would give us false positives, right? Because let's say that my num is 0. What do we get? 0 minus 2, right? We get negative 2, which is less than 0.001, right? So we get, basically we're getting like from here all the way over here, right? Anything less than 0. So if we do one slight thing, and what we want to do is we want to take an absolute value. So for that I need C math, so I'm going to include CMath is, you know, just, it gives us a bunch of standard mathematical stuff that you don't necessarily need all the time, but it's pretty common. A lot of things you do will require that. So, I'm going to say, at, or absolute value, meaning, what's absolute value? It's always positive, right? So if it's negative, it's positive. It's negative, negative, right? If it's less than zero. So what that gives us is we take the difference, and then the abs of it gives us the absolute distance between whatever the two things we're comparing. And if that distance is less than some small amount, then that counts as a distance. So close. Very important. Never, ever, ever use double equals with quotes. The reason I'm emphasizing that is because the compiler won't complain, right? It will totally work. It will even work sometimes. It's not guaranteed that you're going to be off, right? But you can do a fair amount to my num, and two will remain two. But then you'll get this weird intermittent thing where sometimes in a specific, collection of circumstances in your code, this will be slightly less or slightly more. If you're testing for equality, it's just QA team will insist that it's broken. Yeah, so, good question. I would advise that you don't really want to, don't worry about getting close to it, just accept that it's always a little fuzzy. So, because that's right, we don't really have to worry about what's going on down at the tail end of our float. Right? We just want to know, this is guaranteed to be simple. Because we know that if we're within a small number of where we want to be, we could go smaller, but, it depends on what we're doing. And there are certainly libraries you can use if you really want to get into high precision numerical stuff. Generally, that's not important for most things you're going to do with games that like science can do. So good question. But what you just want to kind of treat floats as a little bit unreliable in super high precision. Which really, this is one of the main ways it comes up. They just don't test for a quality. And there are other things where, they'll be a little bit off, like rendering that needs to be tracked, and that can be floating point error. Yeah. Okay. Alright, so, another thing I wanted to talk about is we've touched on this a little bit, but we didn't actually talk about it. And I know people are starting to use it in their code, which is great, but I want to make sure we actually talk about it, is slightly more complex logic, right? So, so far we've seen if, and else, and we've seen while, all of which require clauses we can evaluate to resolve, right? So we've seen a lot of stuff so far, along these lines of if, my, num, is less than 10 or whatever, right? Okay. But I do want to talk about how you chain together logic, right? So we might want to know, we've done it a little bit in that we're effectively chaining together logic when we make an if, else, if, else concept. So that's one way to do it, right? And that is a good way to do some things. Earlier today I was talking about, we had a situation where a player character is going to attempt to buy something, and we have very distinct things that we want to do. Like, we want to tell them, oh no, the shop is closed. And, or, we want to say, oh, you don't have enough money. Or, we want to let them do it. Right? Each one of those is different, so it makes sense to have three blocks of code for that. That's totally fine. But we might want to just know, are all of these things true? You just might want to have one single test for that. they might want to say, is it the case that, yes, the shop is open, and we have money, and it's a full moon, or whatever, right? So, we want to kind of string things together and just do it or not. So, that's where and or come in, right? So, we talked about not, right? So, exclamation point, not, right? The other two big logical operators that we deal with are and or. So, we touched on them the first day of class, but, both of them take in two inputs. So we've got A and B. And make this. Okay, so and means that if A is true, true, false, right? So and conceptually is only true if both things are true, right? So and, logical and, works pretty much the way normal and in language works, right? So if I say, you know, is it the case that it's Friday and I'm wearing a purple shirt, right? That's true. Both things are independently true. Together we take and, you know, that's collectively true, right? So if they're both true, it's true. If I ask you, you know, is it true that it's Thursday and I'm wearing a purple shirt? Well, I'm wearing a purple shirt, but it's not Thursday. So combined is false. Right? Or the flip side of that is, you know, is it Friday and I'm wearing a green shirt? Also not true. Right? So we got false, false, false. Or is nicely inverted of that. So we got A and B. That's true. Actually, terminating doesn't have A and B. We'll just say true, false. True, false. So, and is only true if both things are true. Or is only false if both things are false. So, if I say, you know, is it true that today is Thursday or I'm wearing a green shirt? Well, I'm not wearing a green shirt. That's false. Today is not Thursday. That's false. So that combined thing is false, right? Now, it gets a little tricky, though, because or, logical or, is a little bit different than what we tend to mean in language. So, if, you know, it's Friday night, right? Presumably, you guys are going to go do something fun, right? So you might be thinking to yourself, well, I'm going to go to the movies or hang out at my best friend's house, right? Now, I can say that, right? But that strongly implies that only one of those things is happening, right? So if I told you I'm going to either hang out with my buddy or go to the movies, I hung out with my buddy, you'd assume that I didn't go see a movie, right? And generally, only one of those is happening. That is not the case with logical or. The sort of everyday conventional use of or is something called exclusive or. So in logical or, if both things are true, this is true. So that's the kind of tricky one, right? Normal language, this would be false, or rather, this overall being true would mean that only one of these things is true. But logical or, it's only false if they're both false. There's this beautiful inversion of and. So and is only true if both things are true, and or is only false if both things are false. There's other logical constructs you can get into, but they're all built from this, right? So you gotta start with almost any of them and build the rest of them. So that's kind of good. Alright, so and or, right? So let's say we wanna test some example I have on the handout is like let's say we're trying to decide should we go to the grocery store or not? There could be, is my food stock less than 10? And am I hungry? And is it not nap yet? Right? So it's raining, or I'm not hungry, or I've got a lot of food in the house, I'm not gonna go to the kitchen. Right? So I'll say, you know, cool, and I'm hungry. And food stock 11 or something. and bool is raining. So what I want to do is I want to link those together, right? So what I can do is say, if am hungry and am food stock less than 10, okay, so the thing I want to point out about this is we have three clauses. Okay, so you can string as many as you want together. So, double ampersand means logical and. Very important to use two. So in a minute I'm going to show you what happens if we try to use just one. Is a single ampersand or a single pipe, which we'll talk about in a second, with ORs. So means something very different. So later. So generally what you're going to use is something called logical and. Logical and is two ampersands. And it means this. So what we've got here is, we test this, and only ever takes two inputs, right? But you can string it together just the same way you can string together addition. So the concept of adding numbers always works on two numbers at a time, right? So you can have a big list of numbers. We can certainly say 2 plus 3 plus 5, etc., right? But we start by saying 2 plus 3, which gives us 5. Then we add 5. And we can keep going like that as long as we want, but at each step, we're just adding two things. We're never really adding a bunch of things. The same thing here. So what we're doing is, we start off by saying, am hungry. And in this case, we'd stop there. So, this overall expression will only be true if this is true, and that's true, and that's true. And so, we start off with this. Alright, so, to say, what's that? Alright, that's just a Boolean directly, right? Then we have another clause here, food stock less than 10. We evaluate that. And then we and them together, right? So, to make it a little more explicit and clear, I'm gonna add parentheses here. So this is what's actually going on, is it's kind of doing that. Actually, so what happens first is one of the things that's important to consider when you're stringing together more complex chains of logic is you want to give yourself a way out as soon as possible. This can be an important performance there. So we've got three clauses here, right? So some of those might be harder to check than others. So let's say that we now have a simple Boolean for is raining. Okay, so let's say that we've got, let's say whether or not we're hungry, we just know. The Boolean directly, we've just got correct actually. Food stock, we might have to actually do some work to figure that out. We might have to examine the inventory in our pantry. And then so that's a little more involved. And then let's say is raining is something that we actually call out to a web server to figure out what the National Weather Service is saying for our zip code. In that case, this is the order I would want. Because this can fail. The easiest thing to check should always be first. When you have a lot of ands together like this. Because if this is false, this doesn't even get looked at. If this is false, this doesn't even get looked at. So it's not the case that we actually necessarily check all of these. Yeah. Well, if it is false, it won't proceed. Right? This has to be true. Or can, right? So if this is false, we stop. And there's a similar concept with or. So for logical or, what we have is two pipes. So we might, another way we could put it is if am hungry Okay, so this is two pipes. It's a symbol that it's shift plus backslash, right above enter. And you probably haven't ever used it before, right? And it comes up in exactly two ways. It comes up when you're using logical ORs, and it comes up when you're doing Unix stuff. So other than that, you probably never done. So it's called a pipe, right? So two pipes, two, very important, gives us OR. So OR is going to be true if at least one thing is true. Right. So here, if this is true, this doesn't get checked either. We just go ahead and do whatever it is. Right. If at least one thing is true, if you have a long string of ORs, if at least one is true, the whole thing is true. If you have a long string of ANDs, if at least one is false, the whole thing is false. So, depending on how you, so what happened here is, in the first situation, we need all of these things to be true. So we're being a lot pickier about when we go to the store here. We have to simultaneously be hungry, not have much food, and it has to not be raining. All of those things have to be true at the same time. Let's go to the store here. Here, we can either be hungry, or we can be totally full, but not have much food in the house. Or we can have a lot of food in the house and just be hungry. Either way, we go to the store. Which is probably closer to the way. But so I'm just trying to back up. So let's say that this is, you know, in a larger game, right? Or larger context. You might have a number that constantly reflects how much food we've got. So kind of like the example I showed you guys, well, I put up on the website last week, my management plan had food and goals, right? And those numbers change as stuff happens. So, we could just set this threshold, right? So in this case, I don't know what one unit of food looks like, right? But we define it in such a way that less than 10 means you probably want to go to the grocery store.
So I think the sign should be under equal.
So either way, right? So good question. It's that's completely up to you, right? So that's the designer, right? So to be really clear about what I'm doing here, right? I'm saying that if I have at least 10 units, whatever that means, right, the food, then I'm fine. I'm not worried about it, right? But that's just me, right? It could be the case that that's my level of comfort for number of meals in my house, right? Somebody else might be fine having zero meals in their house, right? Other people might want, like, you know, be like a doomsday prepper. They want to make sure they've got like a year's worth of rations, right? So, anyway, so it's kind of arbitrary, right? And it's also arbitrary as to what one unit of food means. Like, what's one year, right? It might mean one meal. That might mean 1 week's worth of meals, right? Because, you know, it's always up to you guys, when you implement stuff, to define what these things mean, right? So we're using integers, and it for food stock. Kind of mean what that integer represents, whatever it is to you. It doesn't matter as long as you're consistent. Okay. Okay, so I want to preface the next little bit that I'm going to go into with, this is kind of an advanced thing. It's, you don't need to use it. It will make you feel kind of cool if you do, maybe. But the reason I want to talk about it is because this you will definitely be using, I guarantee. You're going to use logical AND and logical OR very, very often. That's a key part of programming. Right? Now, it's really easy to make a typo and end up with just one ampersand or just one pipe. So, it's very easy to end up with that. Or that. Now, that, a single ampersand or a single pipe has a drastically different meaning. And I want to make sure, I'm going to show it to you guys just so you know, because this will compile fine, right? compiler's going to be totally okay with us having a single ampersand or a single pipe. But it's going to give you really weird results. They can be really useful, but it can also be enough. So, I'm going to get rid of all of this. Okay, so, I'm going to give myself a couple ints. I'm going to say num1 equals 4, num2 equals 2. Okay, so, if I say if num1 and num2. Okay, so which one would you expect to see? Now, I've got ints, right? But if we treat it, we can treat an int like a Boolean value. Right, so if we test for an int, we're basically saying, is it non-zero? What's the truth value of 4? Oh, too awesome. True, right? What's the truth value of 2? True, right? So what's true and true? Right. So you're totally right, and this is what we're right? So totally fine, right? If I run that. We see true, right? So what I'm gonna do now though is I'm gonna make a typo. I'm gonna say single ampersand. And you can probably guess what that was going to be, but probably not why, right? So, it's going to change, right? False! So, what's going on? So, what's going on is that double ampersand is logical and. And double pipe is logical or. Single ampersand is bitwise and. And single pipe is bitwise or. So the same thing in that and still means and, right? So we have two inputs, and the output is only true if both inputs are true. And or still means or, and then we've got two inputs, and it's only false if both are false. However, it's working on the actual bit of what we're giving, right? So simple, I think, so I'm gonna write these as 4-bit numbers. Up there, we just got your answer, right? Or bytes. But let's say I've got 4 bits. Right? So what's 2 going to look like? In binary, in the actual bit. 0, 0, 1, 0. But what's 4 going to look like? 0, 1, 0, 0. Okay, so here's my 2 numbers, right? So if we... Now let's do this as if we're adding them, right? But we're not adding them, we're doing a different kind of operation. Not addition, exactly. We're doing bitwise and. Single ampersand. So what that means is we're going to take the first column here, right? So what's 0 and 0? 0. What's 1 and 0? Because it's a true and a false, right? So 0, right? What's 0 and 1? 0. And what's 0 and 0? Aha! So, 1 ampersand is bitwise and, which means we compare bit by bit by bit by bit. Gives us another integer, which in this case, since we have 2 and 4, right, they don't share any bit. So we end up with 0, which gets treated as false. What do you think we get? So, this is enough. See if we can get this out. What do you think we're going to get there? If I, so one pipe, right, is going to be bitwise 4. What do you think 4 bitwise or two. That would be true, yeah, but it's going to be a number, right? So, you're right, that number is not going to be zero. It would evaluate the truth. But what number? What specific number do you think that is? Let's do it, right? So let's say, all right, you want to erase this, right? What's zero or zero? What's one or zero?
One.
What's zero or one? What's zero or zero? What's 0, 1, 1, 0? 6. Yeah. So, and we see 6. Sort of, right? So, you're right in that what we're seeing a glimpse of here is starting to be how computers actually do now. We don't have to worry about too much. But yeah, you're right in that if we OR 1, it'll add to add them. Well, it'll add to an even number. Right? Because if we just have 1 or 1, you just get 1. Right? If you have the same thing. So if we have, so again, let's say bitwise OR. So bitwise OR. Zero, 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 one. Zero, zero, one, zero, right? So it's gonna, in this specific case, it's gonna do something we would call addition. Right? Because we've got 2 and 1, so it's gonna give us 3, right? And 4 and 2 gave us 6. It's not necessarily gonna do that in all cases. Because if we had 3 and 1, right? Right, so this is 3, and that's 1, and that's 1. So what's 1 or 1? 1, right? That's the circumstance that doesn't really fit into normal spoken language. And generally we mean exclusively one or the other when we talk about or, not both. Right, so in this case we get 1, then we get 1, and we get 0, 0, so the result is 3. And that's kind of why I wanted to show you guys this. Not because you necessarily want to use this right now. I want you guys to be aware of it because you can do some cool stuff with it. But it kind of can give you some non-obvious results sometimes, right? If you accidentally leave out one of your ampersands or one of your pipes. Yeah. Yes. So, well, specifically with bitwise and OR, right? So, conceptually, they're very closely related, right? In both cases, there's AND that operates with this truth table, and there's OR that operates with that, right? But logical AND and OR operate on truth values, right? So, the inputs get parsed into true or false first, no matter what else they have. Bitwise and for OR, single characters, actually operates on the bits that go into it. So, you know, you feel free to ignore that. It does eventually become useful. You can do something called, previous class, I think I mentioned that we never really deal with anything that's less than a byte, right? And when I talked about that, I was saying, like, you know, you might have something that's just a simple on or off, right? So a Boolean is still stored as a full byte on the system. Now, if you really want to be really, really compact about that, which you might want to do if you're sending stuff across the network, right? You might be making a multiplayer game where you have a lot, let's say you're making a real-time strategy game that's online multiplayer. So you're constantly sending the positions of a lot of units across the wire, right? You have a real incentive to make that traffic as small as possible. If nothing else, because it will cost your company more, right? And pay more for damage. You want to have the smallest possible network traffic you can get away with. So, you might want to really shrink it down, right? So one thing you can do is you've got, you know, in a single int, right, as you just saw, you've got, you know, potentially 4 bytes worth of information. So you can pack a lot of stuff in there. So you can say that, let's just go with this, let's say that what we're going to do is we're going to have 4 bits, you know, again, just to keep things easy to talk about, and we're going to have this be, represent the state of a monster. Let's say, this is alive. This is, magic. Yes, no, right? Hungry. Yes, no. Aggressive. Okay, so we've got 4 bits, right? Any one of which can be flipped. And they're all, let's say, for the sake of this talk, right? Let's say that they're all completely independent of each other, right? So, aggressive, yes, no, has nothing to do with hungry, yes, no. Which has nothing to do with magic, yes, no. Right? You can have hungry, not magic, but aggressive, any possible combination, right? And let's say we want to store that state, but if we store it with 4 booleans, we're using a lot more space, right? So, and we know that we've got, you know, 4 yes or no's, right? So, ideally, we would only use 4 bits for that. So, what we can do is if we can, so let's say that we've got, well, let's say he's definitely alive, because that doesn't make sense to talk about otherwise, right? Well, let's say we've got a monster that is not aggressive, not hungry, is magic, and is alive. Let's say we want to test, is it magic? The magic using creature is something called bit master. What we want to do is we want to just test for this bit, right? So if we bitwise and with that, what do we get? So, well, and, right? So, what's this? 0. What's this? What's this? Right. Then we get 2, right? So, what we can do is do something like this. So, if we say, so I'll say magic mask equals 2. And in this case, right, so you've got magic and alive. So if that's a number, what number is it? 3, right? So let's say that monster int monster state 1 is 3. So check this out. So what I can do is I can say if monster state 1 and magic mask. What that gives me is we've got zeros for everything but the bit we care about. If we bitwise and it, this is going to be 0 if this isn't set. If it is set, we get a non-zero value. Again, you know, just file that in the back of your head. You know, it may come in handy one day, but I definitely want you guys to be armed with some understanding of what happens if you only have 1 ampersand or 1 pipe. Because you're going to be using logical and logical not a lot, and it's really easy to just out a character and then you get weird behavior. So, this is a fun trick. This is a true game dev trick. It gets used a lot. Question. Cool. Go and take a break. Come back, we'll talk about tomorrow.